Hello everybody, You Know Who here, and welcome to another episode of You Know Who News, where I basically just do reaction videos and updates on this channel. Now, today I'm going to be doing a reaction video. Yeah, I know it's been a while since I did a reaction video, but here I am, and we're still in October, so it's a Halloween video, which I'm going to be reacting to NTC's A Scooby-Doo Halloween Review. Yeah, it's the start of this year's Halloween month. Wow, Nostalgia Critic has his Nostalgia Read, NC Junior has his Reviews from the Crypt with the Crypt Critic, which I'm still waiting for an episode to appear. And now, Halloween month. Well, for us, we just got a bum who just basically does this stuff. Anyway, I'll explain my thoughts on the episode later. Okay, I'll just explain now. My thoughts on a Scooby-Doo Halloween, it's pretty good. It was a decent episode, pretty okay, and it's rocking. The final score for this episode is in the link description below. So, alright, let's put on the headphones and see what we can do. Boils and ghouls, this is NTC's A Scooby-Doo Halloween Review. Baseball Sam 1 Production presents, and that's from the first Halloween month.
Starring Samuel de Trayden, and that Veggieception is real.
What the heck? Okay, review's over. Whoa. And yes, that's from NTC's second Halloween month. So it's the first and second Halloween month music in the third one. Wow. Enjoy.
Hey guys, NTC here, and welcome to Halloween Month. Yes, that's right. A time of year where candy is everywhere, jack-o'-lanterns are lit up, and also we get to wear some of the most sexiest costumes of all time, and we get to see some of the spookiest animated episodes ever created. And it's also a time of year where you can actually make black and white videos and not get called out for being lazy because, well, it fits the theme.
True.
Alright, so now I bet you guys are asking, what are you going to take a look at to begin this month? Well, if you guys have seen my previous video, you know that I did a crossover review with Jedi Bender on a crossover episode between Johnny Bravo and Scooby-Doo called Bravo Dooby-Doo.
The episode's okay. Bravo Dooby-Doo is just literally okay.
It's just a Scooby-Doo episode. No crossovers, no none of that. It's just a Scooby-Doo episode. But not only that, it's also Halloween-centered. Now, what I mean by that is, like, most Scooby-Doo episodes we've seen, they could definitely be talked around like Halloween. Of course, they have a spooky element to it. But this one, this episode right here, is all Halloween. There's decorations everywhere, people in costumes, candy, jack-o'-lanterns, all that stuff. So, which episode am I talking about? Well, it's an episode that actually comes from one of the most famous incarnations, What's New Scooby-Doo, called A Scooby-Doo Halloween.
Jeez, Nostalgia Critic Jr. should have done that.
And this is one episode I still remember even to this day. I remember watching this episode a lot when I was younger, and I've always enjoyed it. But is it just as good as I remember it? Well, it has a cameo from Kiss, you know, before the movie. And for some people that are thinking that this is actually their first time crossing over, no, it was not. This was the first time they crossed over, and this was like over a decade ago. So get your facts straight!
Okay.
Anyway, let's go ahead and take a look at it and see if it's good or not. This is my review of A Scooby-Doo Halloween.
Well, Jedi Bender is right. Sam's mind is freaked up
by what looks like a hay monster in the middle of a swamp. Okay, seriously, what kind of monster is that? It looks like one of this guy's cousins.
No, he would look like Mr. It from the reviewer.
So they do their usual stuff, like saying who this person is and why did he do it, you know, basic stuff you see in any Scooby-Doo episode. But here's something that's actually different. While they do it, Shaggy and Scooby-Doo actually start to get a little bit impatient. And if that's not funny enough, just take a look at how they react when the monster is about to say his meddling kids line.
Would have gotten away with it, too, if...
If it hadn't been for us meddling kids, right? Got it, thanks.
Ow!
Nice meeting you. Take care. Keep it real. We'll do lunch.
Yeah, that's one of the pluses for this episode. Like, most of the jokes here really do work. And just like with Bravo Doobie-Doo, they do poke fun of themselves every once in a while. And that's one of them right there. So the reason why Shaggy and Scooby were in such a rush was because they actually wanted to head to this Halloween party that's going to be taking place at a town called Banning Junction, which is actually where Velma's aunt and uncle live. Oh, hey, Velma's just like Twilight Sparkle, someone who actually happens to have a relative that was never mentioned previously, but now is being mentioned.
Gee.
And let me guess, after this episode, they never make another appearance ever again. Yeah, I was right.
Dang it.
So while Shaggy goes on and on about how awesome the party's gonna be, even mentioning that the band Kiss is gonna be there, Fred starts to get a little bit anxious when Shaggy is mishandling the Mystery Machine's clutch. And the more and more Shaggy is careless, the more anxious Fred gets. To the point where he actually fucking snaps.
Snap just like that.
You're killing my Mystery Machine!
Huh, how about that? Looks like he actually cares more about his car than his traps.
Who's a good Mystery Machine? Who's a good girl? Yes, you are. You are.
Yeah.
So after a long ride, they finally get up to Banning Junction, expecting a nice, warm welcome. But the welcome they do get is anything but nice and warm.
Nope.
Freeze, you trespassing cowards!
Ah! Is it because Nostalgia Critic Jr. reviewed the Blues Brothers?
It's all right. Just our niece and her friends.
Yeah, put the pitchforks down. They're not Nazi worshippers.
So the reason why they were Nazi worshippers.
Because someone has been slashing and burning their cornfields at night, and they have no idea who's doing it.
Probably some dumb teenagers who think it's funny to mess with folks' livelihood.
I don't think so. Teenagers nowadays are actually more concerned about doing this rather than burning down cornfields.
Yeah, that pretty much symbolizes all teens these days.
You see, millennials, when you do stuff like this on your own, you look stupid, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Another never previously mentioned before relative of Velma's, her cousin Marcy.
Ooh.
It's been so long. Look at you. And look at you. You haven't changed at all. In fact, are you wearing the exact same outfit?
Well, yeah, of course they wouldn't change their clothes. I mean, like, could you imagine if somebody actually did try to change one of the characters' clothes for no reason at all? Oh, wait. So Velma's aunt and uncle explained that this is actually the 100th year anniversary of when the town started celebrating Halloween. They also say that maybe Hank Banning's ghost will come back on Halloween night. Now, here's the thing. Hank Banning is actually the town's founder and was their first mayor for over 30 years. But he left the position after he was suffered from paranoid schizophrenia. And it wasn't like one of those, like, oh, I'll just do it on my own. No, the town actually forced him to quit. But it turns out that before Hank Banning died on Halloween night, he put a curse on the town saying that he would come back after 100 years to seek vengeance on all of them.
Of course, most people don't believe that, but we have a record turnout this year. Folks want to say they were here the night the legend was supposed to come true.
Let's see here. So you know the story is a fake, but you tell the tourists this because you want them to believe, like, oh, the legend is supposed to come true tonight. It really is. So, not only will you get more tourists to come here, but the more tourists you get, the more money you make.
Yeah, it's all about...
Sounds like advertising in a nutshell.
Yeah, it's all about the money. The exact thing I used in Larry Boy and the Fifth from Outer Space. Good one, Sam.
She's a savage, but she's also going to be the Mastery Ball's corn princess.
Wow, that is so neat, Marcy.
Neat? How very retro of you, Blondie. I like that.
Uh-oh, I know that look. That's a jealous look. I wonder where she could be on the jealousy meter.
Oh.
That? You don't know what the jealousy meter is?
No, I heard of that. Yeah.
Goes from level 1 all the way to level 10. So
what's she on?
At this point, Daphne's a level 2. The stop hitting on my man jealous.
Can you get back, Stacey? Thanks. Wow. Looks like you can bench 220. Am I right?
Now she's at level 3 on the jealousy meter. The stop hitting on my man while also touching my man jealous.
Wow.
So
this is going to be a whole lot of jealous.
We see that someone is actually destroying the cornfields.
Huh?
wasn't the guy just like, hey, you want to know a sexy location where we can snuggle up and get warm? How about a cornfield? Yeah, that's
what?
The exact same place where Isaac and the children of the corn got sucked straight into hell. Erotic, right?
Yeah.
No, guy. No. Interesting, but not erotic. So the very next day, we see the gang and the rest of the town getting ready for the Halloween party and just goofing off and having fun. Like scaring each other, making jack-o'-lanterns, and also making party balloons, too. And this is also where we get another jealous moment from Daphne.
Then you just gently dip and turn. Oops, you got a little caramel on your cheek. Oops, my bad.
Yeah, now she's at level 4 on the jealousy meter. The, if you keep on hitting on my man and touching my man again, I swear I will sabotage all your chances to get my man. Jealous. But eventually, the rest of the gang ends up finding out about what happened last night. And there's a few things that do stand out. One, the only set of tracks or footprints they could find are the ones they just made, so it couldn't be like any human or animal that did this. Second, after climbing up a water tower, Shaggy notices
that there's
some Halloween patterns around the cornfields. And then they also find a glove on top of the water tower. But the main thing they're thinking about is, what could have made those creepy patterns in the cornfield? But then, out of nowhere, this crazy old lady comes up and says that all this was just Hank Banning's doing, meaning that she's a firm believer in the curse. But everyone else around her is pretty skeptical about this idea and label her theory as ludicrous.
It's just an old legend.
Yeah, I would do the same.
Nothing more than an old wives' tale invented to scare little kids.
You didn't call it an old wives' tale when you were encouraging tourists to spend their money to come here, Mr. Mayor.
Again, like I said before, advertising in a nutshell. So with these clues and a couple likable suspects, the gang tries to figure out who could have probably done all this. But then Daphne speaks up first and thinks of the one person who could probably do this.
Marcy.
Yeah, that could happen.
Why would you suspect her? She's so innocent.
And my cousin. Oh, I don't know. Call it women's intuition.
Is women's intuition just another code word for jealous? Because right now she's at level 5 on the jealousy meter. The, I hate that you were hitting on my man, touching my man, and not only am I going to sabotage every chance you get with my man, but I'm also going to try and prove that you are doing something illegal so you don't get my man. Jealous. So the game
is
going to
be a whole lot of jealousy.
While Fred, Daphne, and Velma go to the library to look up more information, Shaggy and Scooby try to go down to that old lady's house to see if they can find more about the curse. So they enter inside and notice that she's not there. So they start looking around, and while they're looking around, they come across a display case where there's a bunch of farm tools. So after seeing that, Shaggy and Scooby start to think that maybe she was the one that did all this, and was just trying to scare everyone with this, like, curse and try to make it seem like, oh, it was coming back. But suddenly, the old lady manages to come back at the absolute worst time, and needless to say, she's not happy that a couple strangers infiltrated her home without permission, and also having to eat her cat's food. Yeah, there was actually a moment where Scooby-Doo ate Mr. Noodles' food.
What? Mr. Noodles?
No, I'm not making that name up. That's really the cat's name, Mr. Noodles. I mean,
what?
It fits, doesn't it? I mean, a scary as hell cat like that, kissing like, oh yeah, you would definitely call that cat Mr. Noodles. I mean, it's like taking this thing and calling it Buttercup.
Hey, I get that.
Honestly, calling it Atrocity is much better. So after Shaggy and Scooby run away from the old lady, we then cut back to the library where we see Fred, Daphne, and Velma get an unexpected visit from Marcy again. So they just have a little conversation about what Marcy does in her school and, like, what she's doing there right now. And then this is where we discover that not only is she going to be the Corn Princess of the Masquerade Ball on Halloween night, but this is also her birthday, too.
Marcy, I didn't know today was your birthday. Yep, I'm 18, able to legally...
be a stripper?
Vote.
Oh, that too.
Marcy... where were you this morning before you met us in the town square?
Uh-oh, now she's at level 6 on the jealousy meter. The, I hate that you were hitting on my man, touching my man, and not only am I going to sabotage every single chance you try to get my man, but I'm also going to try and see that you actually are doing something illegal so you don't get my man, and now I'm actually going to interrogate you face-to-face to prove that you are an evil bitch so you never will actually be able to get my man forever and ever!
Wow.
So Daphne asked Marcy what she had been
doing.
That's a lot
jealous.
And Marcy says that the only thing she had been doing was a part-time job at the mall. And she says there actually is video evidence of it.
Please. You can't even see her face. That could be anyone.
Hey, Marcy. How's the Corn Princess today?
Ah, man. And now, Daphne, after going through all those levels of jealousy, you are clearly better than me. Shame. Also, here's something else. It might be weird to comment on, but what was up with that guy's line delivery right there?
Hey, Marcy! How's the corn princess today, huh?
That's gotta be like the most sarcastic stoner I've ever heard in my life.
Yeah, it's like, hey, Marcy, how's the corn princess today, huh?
Hey, Mickey.
Yeah, exactly. Mickey, what are you doing here? I dropped you in the cartoon world. How'd you get out?
I used a spell. Duh.
Oh. Wait a minute. You were in there for like 2 weeks. Why'd it take you that long?
They're complicated. Bye.
Whatever. Later that night, the gang reunites in the cornfields to see if they can find anything that can solve the mystery. And they do indeed find something, as they come across an army of possessed scarecrows. Two things. One, that's pretty cool. And second, why couldn't these be the henchmen for Scarecrow and Batman Arkham Knight instead of the pussies he did get? I mean, it's still a good game, but there are some pretty annoying parts, including the drones. I mean, seriously, why? Why do we spend so much time on that?
I don't know.
So the gang gets chased by the Scarecrows until they're cornered by a shed. But luckily, just in the nick of time, Scooby-Doo manages to save them all by blasting a couple of them with a water hose. And when they get blasted, they discover that the Scarecrows the whole entire time were just robots. And after the rest of the army of Scarecrows goes away, they deduce that someone is controlling and forcing them to go someplace else. So they come up with this idea. They make Shaggy and Scooby dress up like the Scarecrows and follow them to see where exactly they go, and then the rest try to pinpoint exactly where they are heading to. And it turns out that the Scarecrows are just heading straight for the Masquerade Ball, which is in Town Hall. Rhyming accidentally.
Who are you supposed to be?
Hong Kong Fooey. Number one super guy. Teenagers, no sense of history.
Yeah, I know. I've had conversations like that before. It's like, hey, what kind of music do you listen to? I listen to Pink Floyd and the Beatles.
I listen to Cardi B, Nicki Minaj, and T-Pain. Those are some of the best artists in the world.
That symbolizes with me. Yeah, that's me.
I have a bad feeling about this.
Carl, I thought we told you to meet us by the snack table. Honestly, sometimes it's like you don't even have a brain.
Yeah, remember when I said that most of the jokes in this episode work? Despite the fact that there are some groaners? That's one of the groaners. I mean, do you get it? It's a Wizard of Oz joke. The Cowardly Lion, the Scarecrow saying he had no brain and all that. Get it? Okay, now at this point you guys are probably wondering, wait a minute. You said it was going to be a Kiss cameo. Well, where's Kiss? Well, here you go. Here it is. The hottest band in the world, Kiss.
Happy Halloween!
Benny Junction.
Benny Junction!
Yeah, I love that. It's like we played in so many places, like Madison Square Garden. Like, what place is this? Benny Junction, Benny Junction. Yeah, that's actually Paul Stanley himself doing the voice. And even though he only gets a handful of lines in this episode, most of those lines are actually pretty good, so
yeah,
that's actually another plus for this episode.
Yeah.
So Kiss start playing one of their famous songs, Shout It Out Loud, for the crowd. And it's good. It's a nice, fun moment, and it's really nice to listen to some Kiss music. But this is where I have another nitpick with this episode, and that's with the animation goofs. Like, here's a few things. One, the obvious, like, you know, repeat of animation when they're strumming the guitars and, like, playing the drums. Like, that's pretty obvious. Second is that it doesn't really match up with the song sometimes. And number three, there's a moment with Ace Frehley's costume where most of the time it's covered. Like, you have, like, the crazy costume. But then there's one point where you see his right arm. Like, there's nothing, almost nothing there. It's just full-on skin. So, yeah. It's not a big gigantic problem with this episode, but that's definitely an animation goof, and it's really noticeable. But while they're performing, we finally get the appearance of the ghost of Hank Banning. Or, actually, he should have just been called the anorexic Mr. Moneybags from Monopoly. I don't know, that's just kind of what it looks like to me.
Yeah.
So then we get the classic chase scene in Scooby-Doo, but this time with Shout It Out Loud in the background. And it's really nice. It's good. I mean, I'm sad I actually can't show you this with the music because, well, you know, copyright, haha. But it's still a good chase scene. Although I will talk about two moments that stand out from this chase scene. One of them is a dumb moment, while the other one is an awesome moment. Let's talk about the dumb moment first. And that dumb moment is, why are they throwing pumpkins at the ghost? He's a ghost. They can't hurt him. That's like throwing a rubber ball at Superman. It's not gonna work. Okay, now that with the dumb moment out of the way, let's talk about the awesome moment. There is a moment where Shaggy gets cornered by a couple of the scarecrows. But luckily, just in the nick of time, Scooby-Doo, dressed up like Superman, comes in and saves the day again.
Scooberman, the man of Scoob. Oh, yeah. Screw that.
Super dog. Super.
Super dog. The dog of Steve.
I don't understand it. Who would go to such lengths just to upstage Halloween? That's it. I know who's behind this.
Oh, really?
Who? Yeah!
Actually, nah, I'm just kidding. It was Marcy.
Yeah.
So the reason why Marcy did it was because she always felt she was second fiddle to Halloween every single year, especially around her birthday. So that was why she wanted to scare everyone and try to make people believe that the curse of Hank Banning was really real. But sadly, she did those offenses, and as punishment, she has to be arrested.
This is all our fault. I can't believe we let a holiday come before the birthday of our own corn princess.
Excuse me?
Your water just happened to break on Halloween night? I mean, look, we could have waited. Like, maybe she would have been born after midnight, like maybe on November 1st. But no, you wanted that morphine so badly that you had to pull on my lip and yell in my face.
Sal?
Well, Marcy, I hope you've learned a lesson from all of this.
I love that.
And another lesson I've learned is to never do a theatrical kiss movie ever again. So everything seems to end happily. Marcy gets about 300 hours of community service. Shaggy and Scooby finally get a chance to do the trick-or-treat that they wanted to do at the beginning of the episode. Daphne gets her ha-ha moment at Marcy. And the gang finally leaves Banning Junction, bringing this episode to a close. So that was a Scooby-Doo Halloween. What are my thoughts? Well, it's clearly not perfect. I mean, it does have its issues. Like, there are some animation goofs. The mystery isn't really, like, you know, that complex or anything, but to be fair, it is a show for kids, so I'm not really expecting, like, a really, like, really good mystery all, like, all the way through. I'm not expecting, like, Batman-type stuff, but I think they could have made it, like, a little bit better. And also, like I said before, most of the jokes do hit, but when there's a groaner, yeah, they're not good. They're not. But aside from that, this episode was actually not that bad. Most of the animation was nice, most of the jokes were pretty good. And I like the kiss cameo. I also love that Paul Stanley got a few lines. And even though they weren't, like, you know, long lines and he didn't get a lot of them, they actually were pretty good. And the voice acting was good as always. And it's just a fun episode. It really is a fun Scooby-Doo Halloween episode. So at the very end of the day, I would just call this episode good. Not a great episode, but good. And if I had to give it a
What's your final score?
I probably would give it a 8.2. Alright guys, that's pretty much it. I hope you guys enjoyed this review, and if you did, give it a like and subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. And also, if you want to let me know about your thoughts on this video and the episode I just watched, let me know in the comments below. Thank you guys for watching, and as always, I'm the NTC, and mwah, good night everybody. So, what are you waiting for? Go get that Halloween candy, try to put on the best evil face you can make, and always remember to shout it out loud.
Oh yes! Yeah, Bizarro Sam! Yeah, Mickey! Alex Beckerall. Reznor! Wow, what a wild one. Okay, so that was the video. How was it in my opinion? It's pretty good. Yeah, like the episode, it's good. Not great, but good. It gave me the smile, and it's a great start for Halloween month. So, what are you guys waiting for? Go watch this episode. And Sam, keep up the good work. And that concludes another episode of You Know Who News. Thank you guys for watching, and forevermore, I'm You Know Who Doobie Doo!